Hello students, I am VLN Swarupini, lecturer in biochemistry from Sri Venkateswara College of Arts and Sciences, which is affiliated to Adikavi Nannayya University, Rajahmundry. Now, I would like to discuss 3rd BSc Biochemistry, 6th semester biochemistry elective paper, that is basic microbiology. In the previous classes, we have discussed about bacteria and now we will see about viruses. So let's see about viruses. So firstly, what are viruses? We have many types of definitions for these viruses. Okay, we can simply say that these are simple and acellular infectious agents. That means these are simple acellular. That means there is no particular cell for these viruses. And these are infectious agents. That means they cause infection whenever they enter a human body or animal cell or a plant cell, it shows infection. So we can call them as viruses are simple and acellular infectious agents. And we can also define these viruses as infectious agents having both the characteristics of living and non-living. So here if you see about these viruses, these are neither in living condition nor in non-living condition, because this particular viruses will show both living and non-living characters. So what is the living character means? Reproduction. So this virus undergo reproduction through replication mode. Okay, but this formation of new generation or development of new generation is a living character. Okay, and here this particular viruses, if they undergo reproduction or generation of new offsprings, but here these particular viruses, they doesn't replicate or they doesn't undergo reproduction process by themselves. They depend on host cell for their reproduction. Okay, they depend on their other organisms. Okay, so non-living character, if you see a non-living character, this particular virus doesn't have a cell or a protoplast. So this is a non-living character. Just a genetical material is just packed in a protein capsid. Okay, that's why these viruses are both living and non-living in nature, because of the presence of few living characteristics and many non-living characteristics. And we can also define them as microscopic obligate cellular parasites. Microscopic obligate cellular parasites, generally much smaller than bacteria, and they lack the capacity to thrive and reproduce outside of the host cell. So this particular viruses, they show obligate parasitism. This obligate parasitism means nothing but this particular viruses, as said earlier, they cannot reproduce by their own. They require a host body. They undergo reproduction in another cell. That means here these are the parasites which cannot complete its life cycle on its own and depend on other organisms to complete their life cycle. So that is called obligate parasite. So parasite means we all know they depend on other host cells for their food and shelter. But here obligate parasites, they cannot complete its life cycle on its own and depend on other cells to complete its life cycle, which is nothing but the reproduction. So here they are in the form of obligate parasite, and these are microscopic in nature. That means only we can see these viruses under microscope, and normal microscope is also not suitable for the observation of these viruses. High resolution microscopes like electron microscope should be used for the proper observation of these viruses. And these particular viruses, they reproduce out of the, they cannot reproduce out of the, sorry, they reproduce inside the host body and they cannot reproduce out of the host cell. And another definition is, viruses are infectious agents that typically consist of a nucleic acid molecule in a protein coat and is too small to be seen by light microscopy and is able to multiply only within the living cells of the host. So by seeing all these definitions, we can understand what is virus primarily. Okay, so these are infectious agents, and as I said earlier, these are packed, whatever the genetic material this particular virus is carrying will be packed, or it will be packed in a protein coat, and we cannot see this microscope in a normal microscope, that is normal light microscopy, and we require electron microscope, and it cannot multiply outside the host cell. So these are the few definitions we have for these viruses. Okay, so why I explained all these definitions means you can get better idea about the viruses. Okay, and now let's see the general characteristics of the viruses. Before that, we'll see a little history about these viruses. So here, the study of viruses is called as virology. Study of viruses is called as virology. Okay, virology. And the term virus, which is taken from the Latin language, it means poisonous or noxious liquids. That means poisonous or poisonous liquids. And viruses can infect all types of living form, including both multicellular and unicellular also. That means here, in the last or previous class, we discussed about bacteriophages. These are the viruses which infect bacteria, and bacteria is a unicellular organism. So here they can infect both unicellular and multicellular organisms. And if you see few scientists, they worked in the field of this virology. Let's see that about their contributions. So here, Charles Chamberlain is a microbiologist basically, and in the year 1884, he invented a filter. So he invented this filter for the filtration of bacteria. Okay, for the filtration of bacteria, he developed this filter, and he, by this filter only, what he did is, when he tried to filter bacteria, still he observed some microorganisms in the content. Then when he observed under some electron microscope and all, we came to know about the viruses. That means here, with the filter which this microbiologist Charles Chamberlain invented, bacteria can pass And also, even though after bacteria was eliminated, bacteria is eliminated as bacteria cannot pass in this filter, this particular liquid or whatever the material he have taken, in that particular material he observed some microorganisms. That means here viruses cannot pass through bacteria, cannot pass through the space given for the bacteria. So that means here whatever the filter which bacteria cannot pass, this viruses can easily pass through that filter. Why? Because here viruses are very smaller when compared to these bacteria. So viruses are very small in their size. When compared with the bacteria, these viruses are smaller in size and can pass through the filter which is restricting bacteria. Okay, and later another scientist, who is a Russian biologist, Dmitry Ivanovsky, he first discovered virus when he is working in the tobacco plants. Okay, tobacco plants will be infected by viruses, and we know about the disease called tobacco mosaic disease in plants, which is caused by TMV bacteria, nothing but tobacco mosaic virus. Okay, this TMV, tobacco mosaic virus, causes tobacco mosaic disease in tobacco plants. While he is working on this disease, he identified these viruses in the year 1892. Okay, in the year 1892, he identified tobacco mosaic virus. And in the 1898, Dutch microbiologist Martinus Benjerink, he observed few agents multiplied only in cells that were dividing. That means here the cells dividing is whatever this scientist explained cell division is, that belongs to the bacterial cell division. That means here this is the scientist who explained about viral replication or viral division occurs along with the bacterial cell. Okay, and he called it a contagious vivum fluidum, which means a soluble living germ in Dutch language. Okay, a contagium vivum fluidum, in English it is a soluble living germ, and reintroduce the word virus. So finally he gave the word virus to this invisible or microorganisms. And the first image of this particular viruses was seen through the electron microscope, which is developed by Ernest Rusk and Max Kohl in the year 1931. So these are the German scientists who worked on microscopy, and they invented this electron microscopy in the year 1931. And after the invention of this electron microscope, we all came to know about much more about the viruses. And scientist Stanley, Meredith Stanley, in the year 1935, for the first time he crystallized this tobacco mosaic virus. That means up to this Stanley experiment, we doesn't have any idea about the crystallization of the viruses. That means whether these viruses undergo crystallization or not is not known, but he successfully crystallized this tobacco mosaic virus in the year 1935. So in the 19th century, viruses were defined in terms of their infectivity, ability to be filtered, and their requirement for living hosts. So based on these three factors, these particular viruses were defined in the 19th century. And at that time, whatever the knowledge they have about the virus infection is, they infect plant and animals. And in the early 20th century, English bacteriologist Frederick Dwart, what he discovered is a group of viruses that infect bacteria, and they are called as bacteriophages now. That means he identified infection of bacteria by viruses for the first time, and he named them as bacteriophages. So here, till 19th century, they know only the infection of virus in plants and in animals. But in the early 20th century, by the work of the scientist Frederick Dwart, we came to know viruses also infect bacteria, which are unicellular organisms. And next, microbiologist Felix D. Herlay, he discovered viruses, when added to bacteria on an agar plate, would produce area of dead bacteria. That means we all know when virus infects bacteria, what happens? Immediately, whatever the genetic material this viral particle is carrying is released into the bacteria, and after that, what happens? This genetic material of virus will be replicating with the help of the bacteria. That means whatever the reproductive mechanism bacteria is carrying, that particular reproductive mechanism is being used by the viral genetic material for its reproduction. Okay, and it will replicate, and after multiple replications, what it will do? It will lyses the bacterial cell. Then what happens? Obviously, bacteria cell will be dead. So because of this reason, when this microbiologist Felix D. Herlay, when he added bacteria and virus to the agar plate, what happened? He observed some areas of dead bacteria. Okay, and in the later part, this particular virology developed for a larger extent, and we can call the 20th century as the golden age of viruses discovery. And in the 20th century, that means different kinds of scientists, they worked on viruses, and we came to know about many species of many kinds of viruses, and which virus will infect which kind of host. These sort of information was invented regarding these viruses. So now let's see about the characteristics and properties of these viruses. So viruses are cellular, non-cytoplasmic infectious agents. These are cellular and non-cytoplasmic infectious agents. That means they contain a cell, but they doesn't have any cytoplasm or protoplast. Okay, so the cell is simple, and in few cases cell organization is also complex, but these viruses are cellular, non-cytoplasmic infectious citrus agents. Okay, and unit of virus is also called as virus particle. Okay, so a small part of the virus is called as virus particle, and here we don't refer this virus as a viral cell. Okay, rather we prefer to mention it as a viral particle. If we have a bacteria, what we call it as bacterial cell. If we have animal cells, we call it as animal cell, plant cell. But here there is no representation of virus as viral cell. Rather than this, we call it as virus particle. And these viruses are very small when compared to bacteria. We all know bacteria are the smaller microorganisms we ever know. But these viruses are smaller than the bacteria, and they can pass through the bacteriological filters. That means filters which can withstand bacteria and doesn't allow bacteria pass through those filters. In that filters also, these bacteria, these viruses can pass, and they are consisting mainly of a nucleic acid surrounded by a protein envelope. Okay, so as I said earlier, nucleic acid or the genetic material, whatever that virus is carrying, that genetic material is packed or enveloped by a protein coat, and that protein coat is called as capsid. So here genetic material is packed in the protein capsid. Okay, and these particular viruses, they doesn't have any enzymatic or biosynthetic machinery in it. That means if you take bacteria or animal cell, this bacteria, it consists of different cell organelles which help in the metabolic activities of that bacteria. And animal cell also contain different types of cell organelles and some enzymes which undergo continuous mechanism for the metabolic activities. But regarding this viruses, this virus doesn't contain any enzymatic or biosynthetic machinery for the metabolic activities. Okay, and they grow only in the suitable living host, and they cannot reproduce by itself. It depends on a host cell for its reproduction also. And here viruses can be crystallized. Okay, these viruses can be crystallized, and Stanley is the scientist who crystallized this virus for the first time. And these crystallization process is nothing but the purification. Okay, we can achieve it through purification. And here if you see about the genetic material which is present in the virus, it might be DNA or RNA. That means we have DNA viruses and also RNA viruses. Based on the genetic material which is present in the virus, we distinguish those viruses into DNA virus and RNA viruses. And these viruses are capable of disease transmission from diseased patient to the healthy persons. Okay, so viruses are transferable from diseased person to the healthy organisms. That's what being happening in the present pandemic situation. And we all know this is an obligate parasite. Only multiply with the help of the host cell. And these viruses are host specific. Okay, as they need a host, they doesn't take all host cells. These are host specific. Particular virus will only infect particular host cell. Example, if we take tobacco mosaic virus, okay, this TMV virus is only seen in association with the tobacco plants only. So this kind of host specificity is seen in viruses, and these viruses are resistant for germicides and few physical physical conditions. That means bacteria is easily denatured with the help of little raise in the temperature or little raise in the pH or little raise in the acidic conditions, okay, but or mechanical disruption can also be easily helpful in the damage of the bacterial cell. Whereas coming to this virus, we can't damage that virus with any physical changes in the physical conditions, okay. And here even germicides which act on other microorganisms are also these germicides also have very and least effect on this virus, okay. So nowadays in this pandemic situation, what we are doing, we are using ethanol as the, ethanol means nothing but the sanitizer. The sanitizer is a base of alcohol, okay. The major compound which is present in the sanitizer is alcohol, that is most probably ethanol. So this ethanol is more effective than the germicide. That's why this will eliminate virus for better than this germicides, okay. And even germicides cannot show effect, but this sanitizers can show effect for little and the next point is these viruses are connective link between living and non-living cells. These are connective link between living and non-living things, okay. So this will be like a connectivity between the living and non-living organisms. Why? Because it shows living characters and non-living characters also. So let's see what are the living characteristics and what are the non-living characteristics of these viruses, okay. First let's see about the living characteristics. Here presence of genetic material is a living character. Presence of genetic material is a living character, and they undergo mutation. We know now this coronavirus, okay, COVID is undergoing different kinds of mutation. In 2020, during 2020, we only have one viral strain of COVID-19. But when we came to 2021, in the 1 year span, it developed 2 to 3 strains with its mutations. So mutations is also a living characteristic that we see in the viruses. And they show irritability. Okay, they show irritability and they are capable to reproduce. They are, of course, they doesn't reproduce by themselves, but they undergo reproduction. That is also a living characteristic, and they can increase their number through reproduction, and they can transmit it from one host to the another. That means they can be transferred from one host cell to the another host cell. Transmission is seen, and they react to heat, chemicals and radiations, okay. But if you see about this coronavirus, it is being damaged at the temperature of around above 60 degrees centigrade. So they'll have effect about of this heat, chemicals and radiations, but each and every virus will act in a different manner. But when compared to the bacteria, smaller changes will give a larger effect. But coming to viruses, extreme conditions were required. Extreme heat and few chemicals and radiations will affect these viruses, which is a living characteristic. And these develop resistant to antibiotics. These develop resistant to antibiotics. That means antibiotics cannot show effect on viruses. If so, in case antibiotics can show effect on these viruses, what is the situation? We have many number of antibiotics nowadays. So then it might not be a big problem and this pandemic situation may not be occurred. But these viruses, they have resistance towards antibiotics. This is the major disadvantage which led for this pandemic. If they have any effect about these antibiotics, then you can easily tackle this COVID. Okay, so this is about the living characteristics that we can see in the viruses. What are they? Presence of genetic material, mutation, showing irritability, undergoing reproduction, can increase their number, transmission from one to another host cell, reaction for the heat, chemicals and radiation, and which doesn't show any effect by this antibiotics. That means these have resistance against antibiotics. Now let's see the non-living characteristics. They can be crystallized like chemicals. It can be crystallized and they inert outside the host cell. If host cell is not there, these viruses undergo in inert situation. That means this will be in inert condition and these lack cell membrane and cell wall, lack of cytoplasm and organelles. They doesn't undergo cell division. They cannot grow in size or shape. Okay, they cannot grow in size or shape and they doesn't possess sort of nutrients. That means they doesn't have any nutrients and they don't respire and excrete. Okay, so here this is the major, we all know respiration and excretion are the major characteristics of the living thing, living organisms, but these are not present in the viruses and they do not undergo their own metabolism. They depend on host cell and lack energy producing systems. Like energy producing systems means nothing but the metabolism, like whatever the carbohydrate lipid metabolisms we see in general cells, this kind of any energy producing systems are not seen in the viruses. So these are the non-living characters that we see in viruses. Okay, let's see remaining topics about these viruses. So now let's see about the classification of viruses. We have many kinds of classifications regarding this viruses. We have Holmes classification, ICTV classification, structure classification based on structure, Baltimore classification, LHT system of classification, and virus classification which is based on their
characteristics or based on different properties. Okay, so these are there is no proper classification mechanism, but here if you observe one thing, we have classification. We discussed about the classification of organisms like Whittaker 5 kingdom and also Carolus 3 domain system. Okay, we have discussed two kinds of classification methods. Okay, but we didn't observe virus, or that means Whittaker and also the scientist Carolus. These two persons, they didn't classify virus into any category. Why? Because this virus is neither living nor non-living. That's why this viruses were not classified in the classification of organisms. That means they classified each and every organism which is present on the earth except viruses. So these viruses have separate kind of classification, and different scientists gave different kinds of classifications. Now let's see about the Holmes classification. So this Holmes classification, he have proposed this classification in the year 1948, and based on this he divided these viruses into three suborders: phagine, phytophagine and zoophagine. Phagine, these are the viruses which infect bacteria, like bacteriophages come under phagine. And phytophagine, by name itself we can understand, it is a virus. These are the viruses which infect plants. And zoophagine, these infect animals. And next one is ICTV classification. ICTV classification. This is the classification given by International Committee on Taxonomy of Viruses. Okay. So International Committee on Taxonomy of Viruses, it gave classification of viruses in the 1970s. That means there is no proper mention of the year, but here it was given in the 1970s. And just see about the classification. So as we seen, bacterial organism classifications, microorganisms classification, there in Whittaker classification he mentioned in the form of orders. Okay, class, suborders, class, subclass, in that manner. And coming to Carolus classification, he divided in the form of domains. And here in the ICTV classification, it was classified in the form of realms. Okay, in the form of realms. And here there is no much importance about the classification, just we are seeing a glance of this classification. Okay, so the realm is virae, and subrealm is viria, and kingdom viriae. So in that form he started classifying these particular viruses. Okay, and the next one is structure based classification. So if you see, we can see different kinds of structures in this viruses, and based on structure also this was classified. And next one is Baltimore classification. This Baltimore classification, he first explained in the 1971. And if you see, he divided these viruses based on the genetic material. So double stranded DNA viruses, so he classified all double stranded DNA viruses in one group, and single strand DNA viruses in one group, double stranded RNA virus in one group, and positive sense SS single stranded RNA viruses in one group, and negative sense negative sense single-strand RNA viruses in one group and reverse transcriptable diploid single-stranded RNAs in one group and reverse transcribing circular double-stranded DNA viruses in one group. So, based on the genetic material, this particular Baltimore classified these viruses. So, if you see here, you can have a better understanding. So, here double-stranded and single-stranded viruses were separated. And the single-strand, we have parvoviruses. And in double-strand, again, enveloped and unenveloped. And again, we have RNA viruses. So, here, positive sense-strand RNA, negative sense-strand RNA, and antisense RNA and RNA via DNA. So this classification mostly based on the genetic material. And in later part, LHT, that means LHT is nothing but the scientists. It is named after the scientists Loew, Horney and Tornier. So these are the three scientists. Let me write Loew and Horn, and the next one is Tornier. Okay, these are the three scientists who developed the system of classification, and they classified viruses based on the chemical and physical characters like presence of nucleic acids and symmetry and presence of the envelope and diameter of the capsid and number of capsomeres. So based on all these characters, these three scientists classified these viruses into major to subphyla, deoxyvira and ribovira. Deoxyvira are the DNA viruses and ribovira are the RNA viruses. And again, these deoxyviruses or DNA viruses are divided into three orders and RNA viruses are divided into two orders. This is about the LHT classification, and the next classification is based on the various properties. Based on virus structure, we classified them into icosahedral, complex and filamentous, and based on the viral host cell, we can divide them into animal viruses, plant viruses and bacterial viruses, and based on viral envelope, we can divide them into envelope and naked or without envelope. So these are the different kinds of classifications that were explained for these viruses. So that is for this class. We see how this virus is organized and how this virus is being reproduced in the next class. Thank you, students.